chills.
Number 5. This is a story and a warning. I'm serious about this. Always block your webcam. Duct tape is the easiest, but there are plenty of other ways. I don't care how safe you think you are, you can be a target. Anyone can be a target. There are people out there who can hack into your computer and turn on your camera without your knowledge. They can watch you anytime while you think you're alone. They aren't called hackers, they're called watchers. I am warning you about this because of my own encounter with a watcher. I was targeted when I entered an online chat room for a Reddit page. I thought it was harmless even though it was for horror enthusiasts. I started making some friends in the chat and revealed maybe a few too many details about myself. I described my physical characteristics: redhead, thick in the chest but slender in the waist, big eyes, sweet face, etc. I figured it would be helpful for people to put a face with a name, so I even sent them a picture. Maybe it was too sexy a picture. I don't really know. But I made a few friends and had fun talking with them. Then someone specific took a liking to me. He said his name was Seamus. I pronounced it Seamus for the longest time until he corrected me. We would chat in the room for hours. Soon it moved to Skype. I never did video chat, only typing. I figured it was innocent. He said he was my age. We had a lot in common. We were both gamers, we both loved computers, and we both had cats. He was funny and sweet. I really liked chatting with him. But soon he started asking me weird questions. Like one day he asked me if I had a bunk bed. I said no, but he kept pushing me, telling me he had this feeling that I had a bunk bed. Truthfully, I did, but why would I share that? Finally, I relented and told him. It was a weird moment, but I brushed it off. Next, he started guessing my favorite bands. It was really strange. It was like he could read my mind. He even guessed my favorite movie, Shakespeare in Love. I didn't like our conversation so much anymore. He knew way too much about me. He started asking if I knew how to dance. I said no, but he pushed me to try. He said, "No one is watching you. Just dance around right now in your bedroom." I told him I did, but I didn't. He told me he knew I didn't do it and he was disappointed in me. He said he wouldn't talk to me again if I kept lying to him. That's when I noticed the little blue light on my webcam was on. Thank God I never used the camera, so it was thrown haphazardly on the side of my desk. It didn't capture my face or body at all. Just the bed and the wall of posters behind it. I cringed a bit and then went to work. Watchers are idiots. They think they're immortal because of the cyberspace between them and their victims. They usually assume the person on the other hand is just a dumb noob who has never hacked a site in her life. Some watchers are just young girls who think it's funny to see into people's bedrooms. But most watchers like to jerk off while their victims sit unknowingly. I typed to him, "You really want me to dance for you?" He typed back instantly, "Yes, yes." The thing about watchers is that they never do anything beyond watching. They are cowards. They get their jollies and then move on. But us visitors, we do more than watch. So I flipped on my view of his webcam. Of course, I'm a much better hacker than him. So his light never turned on. Seamus was an older man sitting in a boring room, probably his study. He had his dick out in his hands and eagerly waiting for me to come into view of the camera. He had been waiting almost 2 months for just one glimpse of me. Pretty stupid if you ask me. So I gave him what he asked for. On his screen, he saw the back of a girl's head rise into vision. He leaned closer, almost drooling. Then I turned the body to face him. The girl's decomposed face filled his screen. She'd been passed for months, so her face was a fleshy pit of maggots and half-eaten eyes. Seamus, real name Ron, screamed and nearly squeezed his dick off. I laughed, but he wasn't expecting the cute little redhead to actually be an adult woman with a propensity for violence. Then I turned the camera to my face. I wore my usual black ski mask. Ron tried desperately to turn off the feed, but I had locked it. He was stuck. I laid the body of the girl over my lap. I pushed on one of her cheeks until it sank deep into the skull. Ron vomited but did not leave the room. I then wrote him two little love notes. Don't bother looking for him. I'm typing this from his computer right now. So as you can see, you should always put duct tape over your camera. That way you don't get those disgusting watchers seeing into your life without permission. But the best part of the duct tape, it provides a challenge to us visitors. It makes it much harder to find you, but we always do. Number 4. Lynn and I met in 2008. She was from a very small town in Washington with a population of less than 500. I was working my way through college as an event bartender in Portland. Lynn's cousin was getting married in Portland, and as fate would have it, the wedding reception was held at an upscale hotel on the Columbia River where I frequently tended to small wine and beer bars. I noticed her immediately, as I often notice women that I quickly convince myself are too beautiful to ever date someone like me. Eventually, as the night went on, she made her way over to my bar and ordered a white wine. We talked for a while about Portland. I sweated profusely as I tend to do around girls like her. She would be spending the next 2 days in the city, and I took a few moments telling her about the most interesting sights to see and things to do in town. "Wow, you should be my personal tour guide," she said, grabbing my arm and smiling. This happens to me so infrequently that I really had no idea how to react, so I just mumbled, "Sure, what time?" and laughed nervously to hedge in the event that she was joking. "How about 10:30 tomorrow morning?" she replied. And so started my relationship with Lynn. She was infectious, with a personality that was so innocent and warm. I immediately fell in love with her. There were a few issues that we would have to work through. She was still in Washington and I was finishing school in Oregon. Lynn was Vietnamese with a very traditional father, who would never approve of her having a white boyfriend. She lived alone in a house with her father, as her mother had passed away several years ago. So going to Yarrow Point to visit her was out of the question. She would come to see me every 3 weeks under the guise of a prestigious internship program. Being in a long-distance relationship, we spoke on the phone and texted constantly. When high-speed internet finally came to her small town in Washington, I surprised her with a webcam for her computer, so we could have an even better means of long-distance communication. In the back of my mind, I was always looking for ways to be with her, as even after 2 years of dating, I was paranoid a girl as beautiful as her would eventually find someone better to share her life with. In 2010, Lynn's father passed away suddenly in his sleep from a heart attack. He was everything to her, and she was heartbroken. When she returned from Florida, where the funeral was held and her father was buried, she was all alone in a house where she had lost both of her parents. With Lynn's father deceased, she was open to finally allowing me to come to Washington to see her, which we planned on doing in a few weeks after my college finals. One night during our usual bedtime conversation, Lynn mentioned to me that her father had been acting strangely in the days leading up to his passing. She explained that he had taken to checking up on her multiple times throughout the day and night and scattering religious artifacts throughout the house. This behavior, she said, was highly uncharacteristic of him. Vietnamese culture and religion was something foreign to me, and at various points Lynn had mentioned things that I normally wrote off as just being a little silly. She explained to me that being in the house alone with her dad was emotional and maybe playing tricks on her. She hated the feeling of being so alone. She told me that being able to see me on her webcam was the closest thing she had to family, and asked that I promise to never turn off the webcam. She meant the world to me, so I was happy to oblige. A few days passed, and it was now the Tuesday before the weekend when I would finally come to see her in Washington. We spent our bedtime webcam session excitedly talking about our plans, and I dozed off with my head on the kitchen table in mid-conversation. It had been a long day. When I woke up, I saw Lynn sleeping on my screen and stumbled off to bed. At 3 a.m., my cell phone began to ring. Disoriented, I rolled over, took a look at the clock, and knew it could only be her. She took great pleasure in waking me up in the middle of the night to let me know she had gotten a drink of water or had an amusing dream. Anyone else would have gotten an earful from me, but her flirtatious giggle made me lucky to have my much-needed sleep interrupted. "I had a nightmare," Lynn gasped. "You danced in front of my friends." She burst into laughter. "What are you doing up so late, honey?" "You've got work in the morning," I said. I was thirsty and went downstairs to get a drink of water. "Great, well, we should really go back to sleep. Tomorrow is a big day." "All right," she conceded. "Hey, by the way, don't for—" After a few crackles and a brief burst of static, the call disconnected. I hated Lynn's phone. She had an old flip phone that dropped calls with no rhyme or reason at least 3 times a day. I held down the number 1 on my phone, my speed dial for Lynn. No ring, straight to voicemail. I tried to call several more times, and each time it again went straight to voicemail. I was exhausted, and though I love Lynn to death, to be honest, I just wanted to go back to sleep. My eyelids hung heavy. A little annoyed, I decided to walk out to my kitchen for a drink of water. The two glasses of wine that I drank before bed had left me with a little bit of a dry mouth as I rinsed the glass and went to place it in the dishwasher. Out of the corner of my eye, I saw movement on the glow of the laptop perched on my dining room table. It was the webcam. Two fluffy brown paws were making a swimming motion directly in front of her camera. As I got closer, I saw a close-up of two grinning faces, one of that silly dog of hers, and the other of my giggling girlfriend, who knew that eventually, after being unable to make phone contact, I would wander out to the webcam to say goodnight. I wouldn't put it past her to turn the phone off on purpose to elaborately stage this scene, me standing in my underwear at 3 a.m. on a work night, half asleep staring at a girl and a puppy on a webcam. I waved goodnight, and she kissed the lens of the webcam and pulled away. I froze. I wet my eyes and looked again. There. It's standing in the corner of the room. It's staring at her. Wrinkled, angry, twisted mouth, hateful eyes. It's watching her. 2 hours later, I woke on the dining room floor. I had a ringing in my ears and a knot on the back of my head. I immediately knew what had happened. It wasn't the first time. Sudden, extreme stress had given me panic attacks and blackouts a few times before. I had never felt such fear when what had happened came rushing back, and I nearly had a second panic attack when my thoughts turned to Lynn. I loved her more than anything in the world. It took me several moments to summon the courage to look in the direction of my laptop. When I finally did, the screensaver had long since turned on. I looked away from the screen as I flicked the touchpad with my shaking finger. It took me another 2 minutes to open my eyes. Lynn lay sleeping in her bed. She looked so peaceful, sleeping on her side, facing towards the webcam. As frightened and confused as I was, relief at her safety gave me a sense of comfort as I desperately tried to process what had happened. Maybe the wine had hit me harder than I thought. Maybe I slipped and fell on the slick tile floor, and it had all been a nightmare. I stared at her. I loved her. Maybe more than even I realized. So peaceful and beautiful as she slept. The light of her television danced across her room and illuminated the bed. As I watched on, her hand began to move. Slowly. Unnaturally. She was sleeping, but her fingers crawled across the bed slowly until they reached something. It was her cell phone. Her hand moved like a spider. Fingers popping in several directions across the keys. What the hell? Bzzz. Bzzz. My phone was vibrating. New message. Don't. Bzzz. New message. Turn. Bzzz. New message. Off. Bzzz. New message. The. Bzzz. New message. Web. Bzzz. New message. Cam. Complete terror set in as the messages came across the screen on my cell phone. New message. Don't. New message. Turn. New message. Off. New message. The. New message. Web. New message. Cam. As I glanced back to my laptop, horror overcame me as slowly a shadow crept across the floor. Something was crossing in front of the television, moving closer to Lynn. I told myself it was just her dog, right? The color drained out of my face when I noticed the puppy sleeping in the far corner of the room. I picked up my phone and dialed Lynn. I didn't know what I would tell her, but I knew that she needed to get out of there immediately and never go back. Damn it, straight to voicemail. That stupid old phone of hers. The full shadow now hung completely over Lynn. Her hand jerked, flipping open her cell phone. My phone was ringing. I answered. Lynn, Lynn, can you hear me? You need to. A burst of loud static forced my phone reflexively away from my ear. On the webcam, I saw Lynn's lips begin to move. Her eyes were shut, but she was speaking. I heard her voice come across the phone, but something wasn't right. She was speaking, but a second, deeper voice echoed hers in perfect unison. Don't turn off the webcam. Argamon would like to see you. Don't turn off the webcam. Argamon is ready for you now. Who? What? What does he want? I yelled in desperation. He wants to eat your skin. The line disconnected. The shadow across Lynn's bed changed directions. It started moving away from the bed and towards her laptop, towards the webcam. As the shadow moved closer, small streams of gray liquid rolled towards the lens. The images coming across my monitor began to shake violently. It was almost here. I could now see the top of its head. It was crawling towards me. wet strings of silver and black hair hanging over its face. I remembered those hateful eyes, and I lost control of my bladder as it slowly began to tilt its head up. And then I did it. In panic, I slammed my laptop shut and threw it against the hard tile floor before collapsing to the ground. I wished for a panic attack to take my consciousness and end this nightmare, but it didn't come. I crawled to the panel of switches a few feet from the wall and turned on every light that I could. I noticed the bottle of wine still open on the kitchen counter and drank most of it in a single swallow. I reached up and pulled open my apartment door and stumbled across the threshold, extending half of my body into the common hallway so I wouldn't feel so alone. A pathetic coward sprawled out on the concrete. My phone began to ring. I crawled to it. Lynn's name was flashing on the caller ID. I held it in my hand, paralyzed by fear, and then the ringing stopped. I took another mouthful of wine and mustered the courage to call back, and went straight to voicemail, and then again and again as I tried to call. Eventually, the shock and drowsiness from the wine got the better of me, and I passed out on the floor after making a few more attempts. When I awoke several hours later, despite the broken laptop and empty bottle, I wanted to believe that it was all some sort of horrible nightmare. Out of the corner of my eye, I saw a blue flashing light on my cell phone. You have one new voicemail. My hand trembled as I dialed my voicemail and entered my passcode. The message was timestamped and was from the missed call I had from Lynn before passing out. Her voice, she was in tears and frightened as though I had never heard her before. You promised. Why did you turn off the webcam? His tongue burns. With a crackle, the message ended. 2 years have passed since that night. I never tried to contact Lynn again. I never called her work to see if she came in the following morning. I never made it to Yarrow Point in Washington where she lived. She was my soulmate, and I let this happen. I was probably right on the night we met, when I told myself I wasn't man enough for her. The only reason I am telling this story today, under the cowardly veil of anonymity, is because my drug and alcohol counselor thinks it would be good for me. So here it is. I made the decision to let the love of my life face an unimaginable nightmare to spare myself. And the worst part is I may not even regret it. Now, if you all excuse me, I think I need another drink. Number 3. A couple of weeks ago, I came across a list of controllable webcams. It was a whole list of links, each one leading you to a website that showed an open camera feed. Schools, backyards, streets, factories, offices, laboratories. All of them live streaming whatever was happening. Some places were in different time zones, and there was little you could see through the night, but others showed people working, passing by, or otherwise going about their business, completely unaware a stranger on the internet could be watching them. From what I read, many surveillance systems were not properly configured, and when connected to a Wi-Fi network, ended up visible on the internet, without even requiring a password to access. I have to admit, it felt very wrong spying on people like that, but, at the same time, exciting. From the safety of my bedroom, I could watch people without them ever realizing what I was doing. Deep inside, I felt like I was doing something wrong, but curiosity got a hold on me. I decided I would just spy a little. Every evening when I got home, I would tune in some webcams for just a couple of minutes. It became kind of an addiction. I felt bad about it, but I simply couldn't hold myself. One cam in particular showed several police officers at somebody's front yard. Then, a few minutes later, someone was being carried out on a stretcher. I went to bed later wondering about what could have happened. That person could have been killed, which would explain the police. I didn't even know where or who it was, but I watched it. I probably knew about the fate of that person before their loved ones. I decided I had to stop at once, but the next day one camera in particular kept me going. In my defense, I almost immediately closed the tab when I saw it. It was somebody's house, but not the outside like usual, it was inside the house. 3 cameras, one in the living room, one on the hallway, and one in the bedroom. I know you must be thinking that's crossing the line, that's what I thought too. I looked at it for a few seconds, swapping from one camera to the next. It seemed to be a common house, nothing unusual about it. I just didn't feel right looking into somebody's house. I closed the tab and went on to browse something else, but soon enough I was back. I wanted to watch. It was a common house, nothing unusual about it, nobody in it. But there was something so exciting about this forbidden spying. I started to look at the details. The TV in the living room was very similar to mine. From the hallway camera, you could see a little of the kitchen in the background. The bedroom was very simple, with just a bed and a laptop on a desk. I became obsessed with it. I bookmarked the link and would watch it every single day. I started to gather the details. It seemed to be in the same time zone as I was, given that our sons would set at the same time. I could never catch anyone inside, but every day there was something slightly different about it. One day the laptop was on the sofa in the living room, the other day the bed was undone, but there was never anyone to be seen. In the back of my mind, I was actually concerned whoever lived in there was unaware their place was publicly visible on the internet. I wondered if there was any way to contact them. Their cameras were not controllable like some were. You could pan left and right on some of them, but not all. But then again, if I contacted them, the fun would be over. It's not my fault, I thought. Better just to leave it. Last Friday, I visited the link again. I still remember like it was yesterday. I had bought a couple of beers and some snacks, planning to spend the rest of the night on my computer. I live alone, so that's pretty much what I do on my evenings after work. This time, I had a different surprise. The video was black in all three cameras. My heart sank. Damn, I thought. They probably turned the cameras off. A little disheartened, I swapped through the cameras. Then I noticed something. I could see a very faint light coming from the living room window. The cameras were on. The lights were off. I felt a rush of excitement, followed by a chill on my neck down through my spine. A realization came upon me. It was always night when I browsed these cameras, but the footage was always visible. The lights were always on, even though nobody was home. This time though, they were off. There was something eerie about watching that house in the complete dark. I looked through all three cameras again, trying to discern something, anything in the dark. Nothing but the faint glow of the living room window through the curtains. I turned the volume up in hopes this camera had a microphone. I quickly grabbed my headphones and put them on. At first I heard nothing, but then it started. A distant, muffled crying. It would come and go in short intervals. I clicked the bedroom camera to see if I could still listen to the sound. Nothing. In the hallway camera there was sound, but it was much quieter. In the living room camera though, it was there. The emotionless, weak, short moan. It would come, then silence. Then the moan again. Suddenly I hear a couple of steps. The crying became desperate, as if somebody was trying to scream but was unable to. My volume was almost at maximum, so the sound that came out of my headphones scared the shit out of me. The voice of a calm man. "Do you want to watch?" That was it. In a panic rush, I pulled my headphones off, got up from my chair and closed the browser. I just wanted to block my contact with whatever was happening in that place. I swore loudly, trying to calm myself down. What was that? I walked to my kitchen to grab a beer and started to get my thoughts straight. There were clearly two different people inside that house. One of them seemed tied against their will. Was that the reason for the crying? The other person, though, was aware of the cameras. Was he talking to me? Well, no, that can't be the case. He could be talking to anyone who was watching. Whoever this person was, he knew his house was being recorded. I searched the internet for a while trying to find anything about it. If anyone had witnessed this, they would all be talking about it, but I found nothing. Nobody had seen it. Or at least nobody wanted to talk about it. I thought about posting the link and talking about it, but if that person was aware his house was being recorded, he was also probably aware of his link being shared. What if I posted something and this person found out about it? Could he track me down? He probably wanted the audience, and I decided not to give him that. Should I call the police and tell them what? There's a camera somewhere showing a completely dark footage. What would the cops do about it anyway? I went to play some games to get my mind out of it. I opened my snacks, had a couple of beers, and after a couple of hours I had my mind out of this matter. My week went by as usual. I didn't browse any cameras. In fact, I did my best to stay away from them. But each passing day, I felt my curiosity creeping inside me. Each day I felt a stronger desire to just peek. Until 3 days ago, last Monday, just a few seconds, I clicked the bookmarked link. Maybe this time I could find out where this house was. I could pay attention to the windows, or see if I could find any papers or documents, or anything that could give me a clue of its whereabouts. Again, the house was quiet. The lights were on, but there was nobody inside. I was creeped out beyond my mind looking at these cameras again. Nothing moved. It was just a living room. I built up the courage to click the hallway link. Nothing there either. Clicking the bedroom link was much harder. What if the guy was there? Could he talk to me again? Would he be looking at the camera? I took a deep breath and clicked. A bedroom, a desk, closed curtains, lights on, nothing else. I tried looking through the curtains, but they were thick enough so nothing was visible outside. I wondered if they've always been like this. The first time I saw this place, were the curtains closed? I think they were. The curtains were always closed. Wait, back to the bedroom. In the bedroom camera, I could see the bedroom and the desk as usual, but not the laptop. I looked around the floor and on the bed, but it was not there. I clicked the living room footage again, and the laptop was not there either. He must have left and took it somewhere. It was the obvious conclusion. I let out a scream and jumped out of my chair. The footage had been suddenly replaced with a recording of myself. It was my face looking forward. I got up and stepped back from my chair. It obviously wasn't live. It was a recording from my own laptop's webcam. In it, I was using a computer, drinking a beer and eating a snack. It was just from a couple of days ago. There was something strange about the video though. I wasn't in the center of it. It was as if the camera was not out to film me. Then I realized the video was edited, slightly zoomed in at the window behind me. The silhouette of a person was standing by the window. A chill ran down my spine and I started to panic. I turned back to my bedroom window. The curtains were open as usual. There was nothing out of the ordinary. The only thing clearly visible outside was the street sign. That's how he found me. The damn street sign was visible through my webcam. I closed the streaming tab on my computer. The living room footage still streaming back my own unaware face from days ago. I closed the lid on my laptop and ran around the house, closing every window, making sure my door was locked. I barely knew how to use a knife to cook, but I grabbed one anyway. I turned on every light, looked in every corner, below my bed, behind the shower curtains, behind the fridge, inside the closet. I was alone inside, at least. As I calmed down, I started thinking more clearly. How could this person have access to my webcam? I remember reading about celebrities having their privacy attacked by people who could turn on their webcams remotely, but they still needed to know how to find this person's computer. Maybe they knew them personally. Maybe through some social network. How could this guy find my webcam? I connected to his own camera. That's how he found out the IP address of my computer. That's how he broke into my own webcam. I reached for my phone and called 911. I explained there was somebody outside my house watching me through my windows. There probably wasn't, but I was so nervous I just had to call for help. In the most stressful couple of minutes of my life, I remained alone before the police showed up. When they arrived, they searched around and inside the house and found nobody. I explained to the officer what happened, how this person spied on me through my webcam. I couldn't help but notice the irony of it. I told them every single detail of it. He assured me there was nobody around and that I could call them anytime if I noticed something strange. That was last Monday. Nothing strange has happened since then, so I'm starting to feel safer. At least safe enough to share my story. It's still hard to sleep though, thinking I could have ended up like that person who was tied up and crying desperately in the stranger's house. Number 2. Love can be an intoxicating emotion. It has the remarkable ability to completely render useless any course of coherent thought, making the feeling of love truly blind. Most would do anything for the ones they love, even if it results in their tragic end. You'd want to be with them so badly that nothing can separate you. I sat staring out of the frost-covered window of my apartment, my laptop casting its fluorescent light onto the glass, causing a dual image of my surroundings to reflect back into my eyes. Just as I was beginning to lose myself within my daydream, I heard a loud bing coming from my computer. Someone had messaged me in the chat room. I turned my attention to the screen and smiled when I saw the username, DarkRaven93. For about 5 months now, we've been in a serious relationship. The only problem is that I've yet to see her face. Tonight, that was going to change. We arranged a webcam meeting for 9 p.m. It was now 8:43. DarkRaven93. Hey, sorry I'm so early. I just couldn't wait to talk to you. Hope that's okay. CoolGuy42. No need to apologize. We are dating after all. I'm actually glad you messaged me. DarkRaven93. I'm so happy to hear that. I'm setting up my webcam right now. I'm so excited. I haven't used this thing for a while now. I hope it still works. CoolGuy42. I set mine up about an hour ago. Mine's pretty old too. DarkRaven93. An hour ago. You must really want to see me. Be right back. Have to go grab the USB cable for this thing. DarkRaven93 is offline. I felt so lucky to have someone like her. She was so vibrant, so lively. To be honest, I wouldn't care if I ever saw her face. Her personality is what made me fall in love with her. I stared at the clock. It was now 8:54. Only 6 minutes until we'd finally get to see each other for the first time. The minutes ticked away at an apathetic pace, and I was beginning to get a bit antsy. The moment I heard the all too familiar bing, my heart suffocated inside my chest. It was 8:59. DarkRaven93, hey, I'm back. Miss me? CoolGuy42, I sure did. Got everything set up? DarkRaven93, yep, took a bit longer than I thought it would. I definitely have no future in the tech business. Okay, calling you now, get ready to answer. A chat box popped up with the words, DarkRaven93 is calling, do you accept? I quickly clicked accept and heaved a deep breath. She was beautiful. Her long wavy black hair flowed past her shoulders. Her pale skin radiated with a pink hue from the dim lighting of her laptop. Her eyes glowed a soft green and her lips were stained with a bright shade of red. She was stunning. I felt luckier than I had a few moments ago. So what do you think? Is it how you imagined I'd look? She flashed a smile as vivacious as I envisioned it to be. I think you're beautiful. I managed to stutter out the words with a shaky vibrato in my voice. I can't believe a video chat governs such timorous behavior. She began to laugh, which managed to make me even more nervous than before. Well, you're not too bad yourself. She paused for a moment, biting loosely into her bottom lip. I'm glad we finally got to see each other. Yeah, me too. We continued talking for a while and it was quite enjoyable. We talked about our hopes and our dreams, our plans for the future. We even talked about the chances of us moving in together if the circumstances ever allowed it. Everything was going the way I thought it would, until her laptop began to glitch. A distorted image of her beautiful face was now presented before me. A loud static echoed from the speakers as she tried to speak. Hey, I think something's wrong with your webcam. It's completely blurred. I can't see you at all. The audio is pretty bad as well. I... wrong... you... here... now? She tried to speak against the static, but it was swallowing her words. Like a boa gulping up its prey. I was about to type in the chat when the horrifying image burst onto the screen. It screamed a deafening scream that threatened to shatter my eardrums. I quickly backed away from the laptop, gazing at the screen in pure terror. Her laptop quickly shut off and she went offline. Not a minute later, the chat box reappeared on the screen. DarkRaven93, hey, sorry about that, I don't know what happened. We were just getting to the good stuff, then my webcam malfunctioned out of nowhere. CoolGuy42, it's fine, but what was that? DarkRaven93, what was what? Before I could type an answer, a video chat request popped up on the screen. It was from her. I hesitantly hit accept. I regretted the decision almost immediately. What showed on the screen wasn't her, but a car, my old car. The car I had gotten into an accident with almost 4 years ago. How was she filming it? I had the car scrapped right after the accident. I couldn't pay for the repairs. The image quickly changed to an askew photo of a woman, lying on a gurney. Her face was mangled, her jaw almost separated from her face, her body twisted out of proportion. I couldn't believe what I was seeing. It was my ex-girlfriend. The day of the accident, she was with me. We'd been drinking that night. She warned me not to drive, but I thought I could handle it. She passed almost instantly after we crashed. I panicked. I didn't want to go to prison for causing this, so I covered it up. I dragged her body to a trench far from the crash site and covered the hole before notifying the cops of the accident. We were in the middle of nowhere. I knew it would be easy to get away with. Over time, I was able to forget what I had done, but it never really left me. I told her parents she'd ran away from an argument. I even participated in the searches for her. They never found her body. Everyone looked to me as a suspect, but without proper evidence, I was relieved of suspicion. The tears I tried so hard to hold back came rushing out. The image of her slant body was too much to bear. DarkRaven's face appeared on the screen. She stared blankly into her webcam, smiling just a bit too widely. Her face began to glitch, shifting between my ex's disfigured features and her disturbing, absent stare. "What do you want from me? Why are you doing this?" She said nothing. "Do you want an apology? Fine, I'm sorry, okay? I didn't mean for you to die. I'm sorry I covered it up. If I could do anything to change things, I would." She unhinged her mouth. It switched between my ex's tattered jaw and Raven's intact one. "I just want to be with you. I came back because I love you. We were going to be together forever. We still can." Her voice sounded as though she was trapped in a matrix. She glanced over in a direction of my pocket knife. My eyes widened. "I'm not killing myself for you. But don't you love me?" Her voice deepened, almost sounding demonic. "Make up for what you did. Set things right." She began to raise her decrepit hand to the screen and slowly pushed it through. I screamed, falling back in my chair, and cowered in fear on the ground. I felt her cold, dead fingers touch the bare flesh of my face in frozen terror. "Please, please stop. I'm sorry, I'm so sorry." I could feel her hand retreating from my face. Then I heard the all too familiar bing. I slowly stood from the floor and looked at the screen. It was Darkraven 93. Her words sent chills down my spine. "Darkraven 93, hey, I tried video chatting you, but it says your webcam is offline." Before we get to number 1, if you've ever been curious as to what I look like in real life, then follow me on Instagram at DylanIsChillinYT with underscores instead of spaces. I also have a Twitter at YT_chills where I post video updates. I'd really appreciate it if you followed me, and feel free to send me a DM if you have any questions or suggestions. If you'd like to see more of these videos in the future, then hit that subscribe button because I upload a new scary video every Thursday. Number 1. From time to time, I find myself killing some time on chat roulette. It is not something I do because I extremely enjoy to, but because it's the only way I can find to socialize with people without leaving the comfort of my home. I have a roommate, a really cool guy, but unfortunately his mom is very sick, so he's visiting his family for the next couple months. One day, after getting back home, I sat down on my bed and opened up my laptop so I could browse the web a little. Didn't take long until I was, once again, on chat roulette trying to filter through all those pervs so I could have a decent conversation with someone. That's when this girl appeared on my screen. She looked like she was crying, but she had her hand on her mouth, trying to keep herself from making any noise. I was about to skip her. I imagined I was about to be pranked and end up on some YouTube video, but she started typing, "Please, please help." I asked her what was happening. She quickly replied that she needed me to call 911 for her. She had entered her house to find that someone had broken in. She slowly backed away and hid inside her closet. She tried calling 911 herself, but her phone was dead. So she grabbed her laptop, which was in her backpack, and the first page that was open was from chat roulette, and I was the first person that she connected to. I didn't know what to do. I could be the victim of a prank, but what if this girl really needs my help? I decided to call 911, but before asking anything, I asked for her name and address. She said her name was Linda. While she was typing her address, I was already unlocking my phone so I could call 911, and then she pressed enter. My eyes started watering. The address she had sent me was my address. I felt a chill running down my spine. I felt weak and accidentally dropped my phone. Words cannot describe what I felt when the sound of my phone smashed against the floor came from the speakers of my laptop. I just stood there, looking at her. She was begging for me to call them. After 2 or 3 minutes later, I decided I had to do something about this. I moved towards my closet, carrying my laptop on my hand. When I opened it, nothing was there. But the girl was still on the webcam, crying. I went to my roommate's room. I could hear my footsteps coming from the laptop. I decided this was it. I ran straight to it and opened it in one quick move. A scream came from inside the closet. I kept my eyes on the girl at all times, but when I opened the door, a glare blocked the view and she disconnected. There was nothing inside the closet. I ran out of there in the same instant. I ran as far as I could. I felt like there was something chasing me. I kept hearing the same scream in my head over and over. I was getting fatigued, but I couldn't stop. I wouldn't stop. Thanks for checking out this video. Be sure to subscribe because I upload a new scary video every Thursday. Or if you're still not convinced, here are some of our other videos that I think you'd like. Enjoy!